I keep thinking that with every video I make, everyone's going to abandon me, absolutely. I keep expecting it. It doesn't happen. It hasn't happened yet. I say, that's amazing. It's a miracle. So maybe with this video, everyone will absolutely abandon me. It's possible. It is possible. I mean, because I keep speaking the truth. I keep speaking how it really is. And that, not many want to hear this at all. But so I don't know. I'll just keep doing my best, because it, if you really repent, you can see arrogance. See, when you repent, you're willing to recognize arrogance. If you don't repent, you won't recognize arrogance at all. So a repentant mind is able to see this whole realm, this universe, this world, bodies. All of this is just it's a mental projection designed to, it's really the pursuit. It's the pursuit of spiritual blindness. It's the pursuit of insanity. We have never found insanity. We've never actually found what we're pursuing. We're still perfect. We're still brilliant. We're still perfect. But the dream of this pursuit is just our creativity. So we're actually fine. But there's all this decoration that is makes it seem like we're in pursuit. We're in high-speed pursuit of trying to pursuing where we already are, pursuing what we already are. It's ridiculous, isn't it? It's so we're pursuing spiritual blindness. We're trying to reach total spiritual blindness. We think death is total spiritual blindness, and it's not. Jesus showed us that. But when you repent and admit to this, then you're able to see all the defenses, all the maneuvers that arrogance is making, everything it's doing, because you're not defending against it. You're saying, "Yeah, I admit to that. That's exactly what we've been trying to do." It's amazing. And one of the great benefits is, since you realize that this world is nothing but arrogance, a projection from arrogance designed to blind us, totally blind us to reality. It's a horrible place. And of course, there are tinges of our creativity is involved with this dreaming. When we dream, we're still our creativity dreaming. So of course, we're not trying to hate the place or anything, but you realize what it's really about. It's about trying to be totally spiritually blind, and who wants that? So when you admit to this, and you also, reason tells you, well, this is like the worst possible place, one of the, almost the worst possible place, this world. And it's designed from error, to be that way. Well, then reason would tell us, well, there's probably a lot better places than this world, right? If this is the worst, the other ones are not nearly, maybe not as bad. And so you begin realizing, you know what, this is probably not the only place there is. It's probably not the only place I can call, dwelling place. It's like some rundown, in the dark forest, and there might be some nice, luxury resort, so to speak, somewhere I could stay there instead. So it opens up the possibility, like, wait a minute, this can't possibly be all there is. This is just like a wretched attempt to blind ourselves, totally blind ourselves to reality. So how could that be the only place there is? It's absurd to draw this conclusion. Totally absurd. So, welcome to the video. We wow what we hear. We don't analyze it. We don't think about it. We don't conceptualize it. The truth is that all of this world is merely, these are just conceptions. It's just a concept. All this is just a concept. A concept is really a pursuit. Pursuit. Well, you got to be pursuing something. There's the one doing the pursuing and what's being pursued. So it's dualistic, concept, two-ness. And we're pursuing where we already are. I've got to get there, got to get there, got to get there, got to get there. Where are you trying to get to? I'm trying to get to where I already am. Okay. That's a concept. Perception itself is a concept. Virtually everything that we're engaged with is merely a concept. It's a pursuit. It's a pursuit. Pursuing enlightenment, that's a concept. So We're so used to concepts, we think that's all there is. It's not true. And what we do here is we practice no concepts. In terms of full stop and the wow, is you just drop labels, you drop concepts. You're not trying to pursue and get something. It's only when we stop pursuing where we already are, where we are, that we realize that we are where we are, inherently so. It's only when we stop pursuing what we are, we realize that we are what we are. You can't. There's not. We're intrinsically this way. It's not like we attain it. I'm being it. There's no one being it. We are it. Being it is still a concept. So there's all these concepts and many spiritual concepts. In fact, almost everything in this world that passes for spirituality are mere concepts. That's it. And very few teachings highlight this properly. And so we have this called spiritual materialism. This is the yoga girl thing of spiritualizing concepts. And it's a disaster. It's a disaster. Spiritual disaster. The worst plague in the history of this planet is actually raging right now, and it's about to get 1,000 times worse. And give it a name, it's called feminism. Absolutely, it's called feminism. Because what feminism says is that women aren't arrogant, only men are arrogant. Therefore, women rightfully are supposed to be the judges and evaluators of our lives and what we do and organize our lives, our culture, the world, and be in charge, because they don't have an ego. They're not arrogant. And this is completely opposite of what Jesus says. It's totally antichrist. Feminism is totally antichrist, actually. And the whole world is bought into this scam. Jesus says we're all sinners, meaning we're all arrogant. The very fact that we're pursuing anything at all means we're totally arrogant. Which it means that we're trying to change reality. We're denying reality. The very fact we're perceiving it all means we're totally arrogant. Let alone believing we're a body in a world. Completely arrogant. But if feminism just brushes all that aside, says no, it's only the men that are arrogant. They have the egoic problem. We don't have any egoic problem at all. We're not arrogant at all. So we're righteous in our stance of we're supposed to be the ones telling everybody else how to dance, what kind of dance they're supposed to be dancing. So you can't get any worse scourge than that, really. This is supremely antichrist. The truth is we're all arrogant, we're all sinners. This is Christianity, we are all sinners. It's not that men are sinners and women aren't. That's utterly ridiculous. Totally arrogant to take such a position. We are all sinners. We are all arrogant, and we have to repent. Everyone has to repent. The purpose, our business of being here is to repent, which means to admit to this arrogance, and then at that point we're able to see how to get free of it. See the tricks it plays on us, because we're not trying to deny it. You see? So what we've got is feminism denying that women are arrogant at all. They don't have to repent. And what is that? It just destroys. It's a plague. It's the worst plague in history. Now, how do we free ourselves from this plague? There is a way, and this is what we're talking about. I'm talking about everyone, not just men, women too. It's a plague for women also. I mean, imagine all these feminists telling women, hey, you're not arrogant. You don't have to repent. That's hideous for you women. It is absolutely hideous. I'm the best friend that women have ever had, because I'm saying you have to repent. You're a sinner. You have to repent. You are arrogant. If you believe you're a body, if you believe that anything's ever been born, you're totally arrogant. Nothing has ever been born. Ramaharshi said, moksha, liberation, means to recognize I've never been born. I can never be born. And really, nothing can ever be born. It's a dream. Nothing is really born in a dream. Nothing is born in a mental projection. This is just decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. We don't give birth to intrinsic spaciousness. It already is. So The feminists are telling women that they don't have to repent because they're not arrogant. This is the worst, wretched Antichrist dogma ever perpetrated on this planet. It is the worst plague ever. And to say, oh well, no, you know, it's a male thing. It's men's problem. They're the egotists. This is all that the feminists say. No, it's everyone has to repent here, and they have to find the means. Now, what is the means to get free of this terrible plague, which is about July 24th? What the Holy Spirit told me, it is like D-Day for this. I mean, if Hillary Clinton, for instance, wins the presidency of the United States, she's a feminist and she's a radical feminist, and she's very unrepentant. It's the worst disaster to ever hit this planet. Plain and simple. But the disaster is already raging. Even if she doesn't win, the disaster is raging throughout the whole world. How do you get free of it? Drop your concepts. Okay. How do we drop our concepts? By practicing dropping our concepts. Now, to put it in very easy to understand terms, we use analogy of fitness. Now, most people are aware of fitness. Okay, at one point in time of our lives, probably we've tried to get fit. You know, we everyone knows about fitness. It's very similar to fitness. Okay, I had a situation today which illustrated it perfectly to me. And what it boils down to is we have to be spiritually fit enough that we don't get trapped into trying to overcompensate by showing off. Because the trick that the feminists, the yoga girls, who their remedy is the arrogance of just spiritual concepts. Say, don't worry, no, concepts aren't their problem. Just have spiritual concepts, spiritualize your concepts, and that's the answer. This is a vicious lie. And you know, what is more vicious? Those who just bluntly say, I don't like what you're doing, or those who say, oh no, I love what you're doing, but then sweetly distract you from what you're doing. Oh, let's go to this cultural event. I think it'd be really interesting. Can you go to this party? You know, there's really, I think it'd be fun and nice. And very sweetly, they distract you away from the Dharma, from your focus on repentance. Which is more vicious? Obviously, the ones that camouflage their disapproval and their sabotage. That's more vicious. What if someone just said, look, I'd really like you to stop that. I don't like what you're doing. You know, it really bugs me. They're being honest and direct with you. The ones that say, oh, yeah, I really love what you're doing. It's so wonderful. It's great. And then they start working to sweetly distract you, like, oh, you know, this, you know, let's go to this musical event. It'd be really nice for, I think it'd be good for you, you know. And they, that is, you know, they're undercover saboteurs. That's more vicious. That's more vicious, isn't it? Of course it is. So what we want, what we have to be, is fit enough so we don't overcompensate out of shame or embarrassment and try to overdo it. Because when you overdo it, you have this backlash. And if you don't know how to handle the backlash, if you're over too much, you're going to flounder. Now, those of you who understand fitness, I can explain it very clearly. I had a situation today, the Holy Spirit was perfect analogy. Okay, perfect analogy of this. But to explain where we're going with this, when you overdo it and you try to show off, you feel that you really lost your way, and you panic, and that's when the yoga girls pounce and they say, all right, I got the answer for you. You know, right here is just the spiritual concept, and you go, oh my God, it's like, oh, that's not so difficult, and then they hook you into the path of spiritual concepts. You have to avoid this. You must avoid it. It is all important. We practice here letting go of all concepts. This is the key to it. However, it's very, you have to get spiritually fit. I work at it every single day. I worked at it again today. Downloaded like 100 pictures of Sri Sri Anandamayi. I'd never seen before. It was amazing, like a gold mine of her pictures. And it didn't even cause a ripple in me. But I understood she gave me that access to that to find it, because she said, look, okay, this stuff can be used against you. If you don't think if you're not really spiritually fit, you're gonna feel, oh, I'm inferior. You're gonna take their evaluation like, maybe you're not really, you know, you're out of shape and that's not good. And then you'll try to play like, hey, look at me, I'm really in great shape. And then you'll overdo it So in fitness, when you overdo it, it's a bad thing. When you're trying to get in shape, you have to be very careful not to overdo it. Now, today I wanted to overdo it because I thought, you know, I got to push things. I got to go, go, go. So I wanted to run doubles. I wanted to run doubles, stairs, run doubles. I'd never done that before. And the Holy Spirit said, no, 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 no. I said, come on, come on, come on. It's perfect, man. I'm ready if I can do it. No, 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 no. You're not doing that. And I was really, battling. I said, no. And I said, well, I'm not going to do anything then. The Holy Spirit said, well, we'll see. Because I was feeling like kind of like inferior, you know, like, wow, I can't run doubles. Because that's really what the real fit people do, is they run doubles, meaning two stairs at a time. Just run two stairs at a time. These are these athletes that just like, wow. So I said, I can do that, you know, because I was overcome. So I was feeling like, wow, I'm kind of wimpy here, see. The Holy Spirit said, no, you're not doing that. You're not ready for it. It'll crush you. I was already tired from walking doubles, like the day before, walking doubles. I walked doubles, and that was just, wow, just hammered me. So I decided, and I said, well, you let me know, Holy Spirit, if you even want me to try to do anything today, work out. And the Holy Spirit showed me very clearly, yes, you're actually going to try, and you're going to work out today. I said, wow, really? Okay. So, but when I'm not running doubles, okay. So I'm working out. I get into it, and a very, very interesting situation arose. And it was just perfectly illustrating how the yoga girls work. There are these yoga girls. There's two different types. I mean, there's some that are just, you know, the fashion is, this is the fashion. They dress that way. They wear their, you know, the tight tights and everything. They look like, you know, they're doing fitness. Okay, they're not really yoga girls, really. Okay, so okay, it's fine. But there was one, like, prime yoga girl there. It was like, wow. Right in front of me. And she's right there, and she's wearing these short running shorts, you know, just very provocative outfit. And she's totally into fitness, you know, just absolutely toned and just, you know, looking fabulous, you know. And so she starts up running stairs. Starts running stairs. And I'm like thinking, wow, maybe I should run stairs, you know, keep up with her, sort of thing. So it's a very provocative, enticing situation she's presenting. And I didn't look or anything. I said, no, I'm just waiting. Let her go. But then you still think, well, maybe if I ran doubles, I could catch up with her. You know, so it's tempting you to overdo. It was like perfect temptation right there. Let me maybe catch up with her. I said, no. I'm not doing. I'm walking. So I just slowly walked, and there's some. I just slowly walked. Very cool. That's what I did. I did a set of just walking. And the whole yoga, this yoga girl did not get in my sight or anything at all. Really, it was just bypassed the whole thing beautifully. Just right. Then I said. Then I saw this kind of, there's a lot of like out of shape people that, and they were like running one at a time. I said, wow, if they could do that, maybe I should try. So I tried running one at a time, and I did that beautifully. And that was it. Okay, that was it. No doubles. I actually tried just one little bit of doubles, couple of them. I said, no. I said, okay, Holy Spirit, I can see. No, I'm not ready for it. And I talked to this athlete, this African-American guy. I talked with him, and I said, wow, he was running doubles, and I think he even tried triples. He's like, I said, man, you're just crushing it, man. And he said, yeah. I said, I'm not there yet, man. He says, he looked at me, I said, I can step doubles, I've done, but I can't run doubles. He said, no, you're doing great. You know, he told me, you're doing great. Meaning, he gets it, he understands. He said, don't show off. He said, what he was conveying to me is, don't show off, don't try to show off. He said, like, I'm a super athlete, okay? You're not there. That's okay. He said, that's okay. I heard that from him. I said, wow, that's very helpful. Very helpful. So, if you're feeling inferior, you're going to try to overcompensate. And the arrogance, which is what's behind feminism, has got this tremendous global situation where they're going to tempt us, they're going to try to shame us and tempt us into overcompensating and showing off. Now, if I would have run doubles, I would have just been devastated, physically devastated. And I would have felt like all the effort that I've been doing to work out and get failed me. I almost felt like this yesterday and today. I was so tired. I said, wow, it's not working. What am I wasting my time? I need a better way to do it. And you lose your confidence when you overdo it. When you show off and you overdo it, you end up losing, as diminishing returns, you lose your confidence. So this is what the Holy Spirit was showing me. On the spiritual path, it's the same way. If you overdo it, you end up getting diminishing returns. You start losing your confidence. At that point, you feel like giving up, and then you panic. You say, well, oh my gosh, what do I do? I don't know what to do. And that's when the yoga girls strike, which is really the arrogance of the ego, unrepentant minds. And the yoga girls are very, very clever and tempting and very seductive at this. And that's when they seduce you into spiritualizing concepts. Now, they may not seem to do it directly. They may do it through a male. But you better believe that male is being controlled by them and is hooked by them. Absolutely. They're very good at hooking male teachers and then using them. And, of course, spiritualizing concepts plays right into materialism. And you end up becoming a slave. You're easily controllable in terms of basically just being a drone, a slave here. Serving the princesses, you know. Yeah, this is what happens. Trying to make the roads nice for them, basically. So the whole key to the spiritual path is, yes, you have to make brisk progress. Just like when you're working out, if you don't make enough progress, you also lose hope too. See, so there's two ways you can lose hope: not working out enough and showing off. Those are the two evils you have to avoid. Okay, this is just basic bedrock Dharma Prince advice. Go to the bank with this. There's two very bad evils you must avoid: not working out enough and showing off and overdoing it to a severe extent. Both of those have to be avoided at all cost. At all cost, you must avoid this. Yes, so the progress has to be brisk. So what did I do? I did two sets, one walking, one running, but singles. Okay, singles. And I said, you know what? Singles are okay for me right now. I said, someday I'll do doubles. I know I will. Okay, but not right now. I'm not ready. Because those are the athletes that can do that. I'm not an athlete yet. Okay, that's fine. I'm getting there. And this wonderful African-American, he just gave me this jolt of reality. He's just saying, man, you're cool. It's fine. You're doing great. He understood. Okay. It's just common sense. Okay. So you just use your common sense. Don't show off. But of course, you think, wow, it's a temptation. And the temptations will be put in your path. It's amazing how it happens. People might think, well, it only happens to me. No, it happens to everybody. Everywhere. This is a plague on this planet. Man, it's always been that way. It is people are tempted to show off or try to emulate or try to compete, which undermines their spiritual progress. If I had tried to run doubles, I might not sleep at all. I might feel just hideous tomorrow, and I might not work out for a week. I might just quit. I can't do it. I'm wiped out. And then you start feeling, whoa, I can hardly walk. All the effort I've made is just all in vain because now I should be dancing, and here I can't even move. It's horrible. And you start getting second thoughts, doubts, all that stuff starts churning in your mind. And that's exploited by the ego, by arrogance. They exploit that. And you realize, you look back in your life, this is what's happened to my life. You'd see, this is what has happened. Wow. It's supremely difficult because we're so lazy here. Most of us don't work out enough spiritually. We don't. Or physically. But we don't work out enough spiritually at all. We're so lazy. And therefore, it's easy for us to feel, to get this desperation. Oh my God. To get this embarrassment. Shame is great. Desperation is great. But you have to recognize it properly. But if you want to stay lazy, if you don't repent and you want to stay lazy, these yoga girls will make you think like, hey, you're like really lazy, but you weren't so lazy, you might have a chance at hooking up with me. Because I'm this awesome princess babe, yoga girl babe. And you could be in my echelon, wow, where it's all beautiful, the beautiful people. And you're so lazy and so out of shape spiritually that what do? You try to show off and overdo it. That makes you feel even worse, like you're a totally incompetent idiot. And then you're desperate. And then she comes and says, oh, don't worry. No, you're not really. Actually, you're great. But here, we'll show you how to be really great. And then it seems to boost your self-esteem again. Oh, okay. Oh, she thinks I'm okay now. But really, they've hooked you. A fish has been hooked. You're a fish and you've been hooked because your laziness got you. And it gets almost everyone here. So you have to be in really good spiritual shape. And this is what I've been trying to get everybody in the world, certainly those who are listening to these videos, to get in really good spiritual shape. Be really fit. Now, could you be more fit? Of course. But if you're fit enough, you can say, well, I'm pretty close to running doubles, but I know I don't want to backslide too much, so I know I'll get there pretty soon. So you don't really feel shamed, or you don't feel, you're not lazy. So you know you're going to get there. Why risk showing off and losing your confidence? This is stupid. It's stupid. So you don't do it. So I shrugged and said, well, I'll get to doubles. I know I will. I mean, I started out 8 months ago. Let's say nine. It's almost 9 months ago. It's going on almost 10 months, actually. Yeah, started in September. Dieting and working out. I don't think I even started working out then, though, but that came a little later. But let's just say started 10 months ago. I couldn't even walk up a flight of stairs. Let's say a flight is 10 steps. Without just killing me. I was like, oh, no. Where's the elevator? Really, where's the elevator? I'm not walking up those stairs. You know how that is when you're really out of shape. You're not going to walk up 10 stairs, right? It's like I could walk up a couple, but I felt tired. It's like, wow, this is terrible. Now, I could just crush 600. So it's just the amount of progress I've made in 10 months is just astonishing, actually. It's astonishing. So this tells you what if you're industrious, what you can do. So the progress has been extraordinary. But relative to these great athletes, no, I'm still, got a long ways to go. That's fine. But a great athlete told me, you're fine, you're doing great. So I'll take his word, so he's not trying to embarrass me. He gets the picture. I mean, he's like, 20 years old and built like a Ferrari, And I'm like 60 and just, huffing and a puffing. So he understood. Spiritually, it's the same thing. We're not there yet. to accepting no concepts, you know, and ending our pursuit of nothing really, pursuit of where we already are, end our pursuit of where we already are, but we're getting close. And we know if we're very industrious and we work out every day, we know we're going to get there pretty soon. So why should we risk it and show off? See, don't overdo it. Go fast, but don't overdo it. So, here's an example also. I have this slideshow that's like 7 hours, almost 8 hours long. Okay. But the Holy Spirit said, no, you're not releasing that. I'm not letting you release that. I don't care if anyone begs for it, they're not getting it. It's overdoing it. So I did this darshans that are half an hour, okay, about a half an hour. Holy Spirit says, half an hour is okay. That's fine. It's a good workout. It's a strenuous workout, half an hour. But not an 8 hour darshan. It's going to be too much. It's overload you. And I said, so it was a tough one for me. I said, well, okay, yeah, you're right. Now, I might be able to do it. But I'm like a really very much in shape spiritual athlete. And there is not many of those around at all. And even if there are, I wouldn't do it. They can do it for themselves if they want to. Okay. But you can be very careful about overdoing it. Also very careful about not doing enough. So there's this middle ground. Okay, where you're pushing it. You're really pushing it. Like I did today, I pushed it. But I didn't wipe myself out. So by all means, push it. But do not wipe yourself out. And this is where coffee and caffeine and this is a big problem. If I like been chugging energy drinks, I probably would have tried to do doubles. I wouldn't feel the pain. You know, it's a painkiller. It's a painkiller and also, you know, energizer. And so you don't really feel how terrible you feel, but later you will. So it's the same thing on the spiritual path. You will easily overdo it if you use stimulants, caffeine, etc. You'll easily overdo it, and then you will feel these diminishing returns, and the path becomes very ragged, and then you're very tempted to start spiritualizing concepts, having, you know, spiritual concepts, and this is the road to disaster, actually. Very much the road to disaster. But many have taken this road to disaster and regretted it extremely later on. So temptation arises in this world, and also help arises. This is what happened today. It's very, very interesting. But this is always happening in this world, actually. The arrogance of the ego is always tempting us in one way or the other. And unfortunately for this world, again, it's the worst crisis in history coming up. The worst plague in history is raging right now, which is a plague of non-repentance. Like another African-American showed me, you know, it's amazing. I'm running into all these African Americans who have some wisdom, and they're willing to share it with you. You know what? They have common sense. Some of them, you know, the ones I have met, because I treat them like, hey, you've got something important to tell me, you know, and they say, hey, people have lost the fear of God. They don't have it anymore, which means that they don't feel they need to repent, which is feminism. Feminism has brought this scourge upon the world. And unfortunately, most of the children in the world right now were taught by feminist ideology, women who are feminists, who have a feminist ideology. And they're absolutely clueless about repentance. They have no idea what you're talking about. I had a feminist, I brought up the word repentance, she goes, what is that? I have no idea what you're talking about. Like, totally puzzled. I mean, how could you not know what repentance is in this world? This is our business here. This is our sole business here, is to repent. And Jesus Christ, a greater teacher, has never walked this world. told us we must repent, and we don't have a clue what that is. What is that except extreme arrogance? You know, total arrogance. Just it's arrogance. I don't need to say it. Total. All arrogance is really total arrogance. It's willful blindness. It's willful ignoring. Ignorance. Buddha said the problem is ignorance, desire to be blind to reality, to pursue what we already are. Or pursuing what we already are. How stupid is that? How arrogant is that? We're pursuing what we already are. So we don't have to establish anything. We just need to stop pursuing. And then we'll know it. We'll experience what we already are. Say, oh, I was stupid. I don't need to pursue what I am. It's like intrinsic space. Just I'm pursuing it. Yeah, I got to find him. I got to catch it. I'm trying to catch it. All the while, we're in it the whole time. We can never leave it. I'm pursuing spaciousness. It's just ridiculous, of course. And yet, that's what we're doing. So, the younger generation in this world is really in big trouble. They don't have a clue what repentance is, most of them. Most of them. Because the feminist ideology has been around for, you know, pretty much 60 years, my whole life actually. Span of 60 years, pretty strong 60 years. And it's used the mass media, and which gives it more clout than anything in history. I mean, so the children are indoctrinated and brainwashed by this. And the males think that their purpose is to just do whatever the women tell them to do. And worship them and dote upon them and do whatever they tell, because they think, well, the women aren't arrogant. We're the bad ones. They're the good ones. By the way, there's no such thing as a good mind. There's either an arrogant mind or a repentant mind. Okay, and the mind is actually perfect. You know, why? How dare we call it good, as Jesus said? How dare you call me good? Don't call me good. You don't call the Son of God. You don't call Spirit. You don't call perfection good. That's arrogance, to just say good and bad. That's total arrogance. We're perfect. Is that good arrogance and bad arrogance? Arrogance is just arrogance. It's denial of perfection. So they've been taught that they're, you know, the bad ones, and women are the good ones. And so they just feel like, of course we have to do what they tell us to do. I mean, we don't know what to do, what's right. We're wrong. We're bad. And they're, you know, infallible. They know, they intrinsically know what is right, how to evaluate us. I mean, it's inborn in them. God created women to know exactly what is right, and tell men who because God created as stupid to tell the men what to do. This is, of course, totally arrogant and absurd. God did not create bodies in the first place. So it's just absurdity piled upon absurdity piled upon absurdity piled upon absurdity. And again, well, let us just coast a little bit here. Let us just coast a little bit. Just hear this and say, wow. It's already resonating for those who are repentant. It is already resonating. Sometimes I speak trying to convince people to repent, but I have to be aware that those who have already repented need a little time for to settle in, because they're hearing this and they're realizing that what they did as repenting was absolutely right. And that's quite a shock, isn't it? Because in their minds, our minds were saying, did I really do the right thing? I hope so. I'm not really sure. And deep down we think, maybe it'd be better if I didn't, because I don't really want to succeed too much. You know, it's like, uh-oh. But yeah, the repent is exactly the right thing to do. So it's pretty shocking when you realize you made the right move. I worked out a lot today. Did upper body too. A lot of upper body. Did core also, and flexibility. I did everything. Flexibility, core. I did weights for my arms and stuff. You know, I haven't done that in a long time. I did everything. And it felt great. It felt great. It really felt great. I felt wonderful. It's a good feeling knowing that you really put in a full total workout and walking around feeling like, I feel like I'm really benefiting from this. So, you know, doing a total spiritual workout every day is all pretty awesome too. But again, don't overdo it just to try and impress somebody. That's the worst thing you can do. Don't try to impress anyone. Because nobody sits in judgment of you or evaluation of you except the Dharma Kings. And you want to drag race them, fine. They're in charge of it. They'll like the Holy Spirit today. I put Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodo in charge of my day, and he and the Holy Spirit made sure I did the right thing. Did it perfect, actually. But boy, was the temptation put in front of me to overdo it, to show off. And we've all been caught by this in one way or the other. Women tend to compete with other women in how they look and how good they are at getting the guys to show off for them. And so there's a temptation there, very strong temptation. Yeah, it's interesting. And there were these really dumpy looking women there. They just, you know, they're so out of shape. I couldn't believe they're out of shape, but they were doing it. But I didn't really need to show off for them or prove anything. There wasn't any of that feeling there at all. They weren't even paying any attention. They don't care. You know, they weren't trying to, you know, do that thing. You can feel it. You can feel it. So you just stay within yourself then. Those of them at least have some idea of repentance. You know, it's like, hey, don't show off for me. You know, I'm not into that. You know, I'm trying to repent my own life. You take care of your repentance, I'll take care of mine. That's how culture, right culture, goes like that. You know, don't you dare be going showing off. You know, what do you think I am? You know, some non-sinner? No, I'm a terrible sinner. And I have no way of evaluating you. Only Jesus can, or only Holy Spirit can, or only, you know, Krishna can, or whatever, you know, only Allah can, or whatever you want to say. Only the Guru can. In other words, look, we're arrogant. How can arrogance judge arrogance properly? It cannot. So you get this, got a very different vibe there. You get the two different vibes. The yoga girl, you could just tell, you know, was just there to provoke, very provocative, to provoke, be provocative, which never leads to anything good. Okay, it never does. Keep this in mind. Being provocative never leads, it only leads to arrogance. That's arrogance. And the others there were non-provocative, and it led to the right kind of workout. You see that? They said that Western women are going to save the world. No, they're going to ruin the world. They already have ruined it, actually. Because they're the ones that are being so provocative, actually. They're the ones who have done this. A lot of third world women are not like that. They say, no, 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 what are you talking about? I mean, you know, hey, we got a fear of God. They still have the fear of God, like we're sinners. I mean, if we mess up, we're going to suffer. And they're right. Because if you don't repent, you are going to suffer really badly. So Jesus told us the truth. Jesus told us the truth. So Western women have really ruined the world. They've brought this scourge, the worst plague in history, upon the world. The high standard of living went to their heads, really did. It's someone told me something today. It was quite extraordinary. It is very much the truth. This is insider stuff. And basically the dynamic is, if you're dealing with service industries, houses, okay, in whatever capacity you're in, the woman, women are driving the economy as far as we want to do this, we want to do this, we want to do this, 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 this. And the husband is saying, great, great, you know, get her out of my hair because she's just bugging me all the time. Okay, go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. But what happens is they want to do more and more and more, and they can't stop. It's like, they're like addicts. And the poor husband said, whoa, 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 wait a minute. How are we going to pay for this? We'll take out a second mortgage. You know, put it on our credit cards, whatever. They're like addicts. And this ruins marriages. I mean, it puts terrible strain on the marriage, actually. And, you know, you got to know when to back off, because the women, they don't want to back off because they're spending their husband's money a lot, you know, most of them. It's, yeah, you know, oh, I don't like, the, you know, what the tile, whatever. I don't like what you've done. Do it again. Well, who's paying for this? Whoa, 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 whoa. So it creates tremendous conflict in the marriage, actually. A lot of marriages break up from this, actually. And right now, the women, the wealthy ones, Western wealthy women, has gone to their head. They say power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. And the affluence has gone to their head very badly. And they're out of control. And they just simply think that, you know, that they should be able to wave a magic wand, like Tinkerbell, or I don't know who does it, but, and, you know, boom, I got a palace. Oh, I don't like this palace. I feel agitated. Oh, okay, another palace. Yeah, but who's paying for the palace? Who's making the palace? You know, all this stuff. So, and of course, it's your fault that the agitation hasn't ended. What's causing the agitation? Their own arrogance. But they're locked into this belief that women aren't arrogant. So it can't be their fault. It can't be their arrogance. It has to be you. You have to be the problem. This is what feminism teaches everyone, is the males have to be the problem. They have to be, because we women, we're not arrogant. We don't have an ego. So it can't be us. The agitation can't be caused by our own arrogance, because we don't have any. So it has to be the men's arrogance that's causing us the problem. This is the dreadful, dreaded, deadly scourge that is just destroying this planet spiritually, from a spiritual standpoint. It is destroying our spiritual momentum, which is based on our willingness to repent and admit our own arrogance. We have to admit our own arrogance and say, God, yeah, I tried to change reality. I absolutely did. I tried to be greater than you. God knows that and says, wonderful, I'm glad you're seeing that now. Because that's key. Just tell God that. Is God going to get angry? Is God going to say, oh, you did? I didn't know that. You know, oh, how terrible. I thought you'd, you know. Of course God knows this. From the instant, you know. Has always known this. There's no anger because we haven't done anything to reality at all. This is good. He said, great. I'm so, you know. Again, God is so happy when we repent, because God knows this is the way to our happiness, to recovering our true happiness that He created us as. It's the only way. So of course, God is, you know, just wow. But we're afraid God will be overjoyed. Oh, wonderful! No, God is very, very calm, and just yeah, okay. So now listen to the Holy Spirit and take, you know, take the path. You can take the path. You'll do it. I have absolute faith. You will do it. July 24th, over a year ago, I believe, the Holy Spirit pointed out this summer, said the summer 2016 is going to be where the trouble really hits the fan. And then a while back, it pinpointed July 24th, said that's the day. I said, why? I didn't have no idea. And then I tried to figure out, why is this date so important? Well, it's an important day in Jewish history. I think they call it the 17th of Tammuz or something. It's a date in history, actually, in the Jewish calendar, where all the terrible misfortunes have happened to the Jewish people. The walls of Jerusalem were breached, all this stuff. The stone tablets of Moses were broken. That's the very date. I said, oh my gosh, that's extraordinary. Then I found out that date is right in between the Republican and Democratic National Conventions in the United States, where they select their candidate for president. It's smack dab right in the middle. And I said, oh my gosh. Because this is when the mental agitation is likely to reach a boiling point and is going to begin to become contagious. You know, you put it like a rag of lacquer thinner somewhere, and this is because it actually happens. And it will spontaneously combust, actually. You don't have to light a match. Some stuff evaporates in such a rapid way, such a hot way. It gets so hot that it sets itself on fire. So if you have a rag of lacquer thinner soaked in lacquer thinner, it'll set itself on fire. There's a number of things, acetone maybe do it. There's a number of solvents that do this. You have to be very careful not to leave any of those kind of rags around. They'll set themselves on fire. Well, it's the same thing, that mental agitation can set itself on fire. It's very combustible. And we don't seem to realize that you reach a certain threshold of mental agitation and suddenly your mind goes on fire. And this is when the trouble starts, is you can't sleep anymore. And if you're a feminist, you're going to say, well, men are just behaving hideously. We've got to just absolutely crush them now. Absolutely crush them. I'll tell you something. Still, to this day, and I drive all throughout the Bay Area. I mean, I go everywhere. I mean, South Bay, so to speak. But I'm sure it's no different than the North Bay. I still have not seen a single, not even one bumper sticker or sign for Donald Trump here in this entire Bay Area. Not one. Zero. How is that even remotely possible unless you're living in an extremely fascist place? The whole idea of American democracy is checks and balances, and two parties keep the other in check, and so you don't want one gaining absolute ascendancy, okay? It's very bad. That goes to dictatorship, and that's what we want to avoid here. So always there's this dialectic. You're supposed to have the dialectic here, political dialectic. There's no political dialectic in the Bay Area. None. This is just, it's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. It's shocking. And someone told me, if you put a Trump sticker, your vehicle will be vandalized. He said, don't do it. You know, it's a dangerous thing, really dangerous. So are we living in a democracy? Or are we living in a dictatorship here in the Bay Area? It's a dictatorship. Are you telling me that everyone in the Bay Area thinks that Hillary Clinton is the answer for our future? Of course, many say Bernie Sanders, I don't, but they'll vote for Hillary, believe me. And there's nobody that says, wait a minute, you know, even if it's a good thing, 8 years of you know, the liberal non-repentant mindset, that's more than enough. Now let's go back to, you know, a different mindset, and let's get the checks and balances going here, and let's not go too far down the any rabbit hole here. Oh no, that doesn't ever even occur to them. They're so sure that they're right, because absolutely, because of course they're not arrogant. You are. See, they're not arrogant. It's the other ones that are arrogant. Hey, whatever happened to we're all arrogant? Whatever happened to we're all sinners? Although that they got did away with it. It's called progress. It's called the Enlightenment. It's progress, liberal progress. Oh yeah, we're not arrogant because we had an education and we're smart now. See, but we're not. It's just those idiots. You know, those people over there, those idiots. They're the arrogant ones. And so, you know, you get this both sides, you know, slinging back and forth. You get mental agitation. Whatever happened to everybody humbly going to God and saying, God, I'm a sinner. I'm arrogant. Please show me the way to drop my arrogance. Even though it may be very difficult and I have to really be get after it, show me the way to drop my arrogance. Whatever happened to that? Because that's the core of Christianity. It's the absolute core, and it's the absolute necessary core. It is absolutely indispensable we recognize our arrogance here. Otherwise, you're going to get caught up in spiritualizing your concepts, and you're going to become a fascist guru or something. I mean, ultimately, it leads to severe exploitation, wars, conflict. All evils come from it. A lack of repentance gives rise to the whole gamut of our misery that we've been dragged through the mud of our own misery for so long. It's arrogance. So to lose this mood of repentance is the worst calamity this world can have. The worst. And this is what has happened. And now it's become fashionable, and people are now slaves to fashion. As this older elderly lady told me, about my age, don't, she told me, don't be a slave to fashion, in her wonderful East Coast Brooklyn accent. I mean, don't be a slave to fashion. do not do. You do not do it. You know, you can, must not be a slave to fashion. It's so important. Just, I don't have a smartphone because that's fashion. You know, I don't need to have one. I don't want to have one. So don't be a slave to fashion. Well, people are slaves to fashion right now. Mass media has made zombie slaves to fashion now in terms of what is the uber fashion of the day? Refusing to repent. In fact, not even knowing that it's even a possibility. That's the fashion of the day. Losing the quote-unquote fear of God. Meaning, if you don't repent, then you're going to be suffering real bad. Which is true. Not because God's punishing us, because we're dragging ourselves through the mud of arrogance, which always compounds itself into more and more suffering. More and more mental confusion, more and more mental agitation, more and more instability, more and more hostility, projection, mental bifurcations and imaginary splits and compartmentalization and all these various problems that psychiatrists deal with. It gets worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. You end up being extremely self-righteous in an arrogant way instead of being adamant in a repentant way. Okay, there's a big difference between the two. We're very adamant here, okay, but we're doing it from the standpoint of repentance. So the troubles are about ready to hit the fan. Again, remember the spontaneous combustion principle. We might think, no, I'm okay. Well, we may not be okay pretty soon. There may be extreme agitation taking place. The prospect of Hillary Clinton being president, putting a radical feminist in charge of basically the most powerful position in the world, is basically pouring, you know, gasoline. You get like an arsonist in the White House, basically, a spiritual arsonist in the White House is what we'd be doing. Absolutely. It's unthinkable for many people. It's absolutely unthinkable. Giving carte blanche to the feminists, the unrepentant ones, the arrogant ones, who then just will crush the planet's spiritual momentum, and all doing it in all sort of a camouflage way of camouflaging their sabotage by pretending to be sweet and nice and helpful, but leading us into conceptualizing spirituality, spiritual concepts, spiritualize our concepts, which is a dead end. It's a terrible dead end. So it's just unthinkable. It's absolutely unthinkable. Yeah, the unthinkable might happen. And then many are terrified of Trump. You're absolutely phobic of him. There's a terrible Trump phobia. They're Trumpophobic. You know, there's a disease. They're Trumpophobic. They're suffering from Trumpophobia. Are you a Trumpophobe? This is what people just say. Are you a Trumpophobe? Really? Well, that's really bigoted. And you know, flip the script. You know, they're Trumpophobes. Is what it is. It's a sickness. I mean, just look at the situation objectively and see it for what it is instead of being phobic. It's amazing. Those people who call everybody else phobic, they're suffering from the worst phobia of all. I mean, they're Trumpophobic too. And this is, of course, their arrogance. Just instead of recognizing Hillary for what she is, arrogance says, no, don't look, just project all your agitation to Trump. He's the one. He's the problem. It's diversion. They're diverting. If they just look at her and say, wait a minute, do we really want a radical feminist in charge of the world? You know, spiritual arsonist in the White House? That's crazy. But no. It's all, you know, Trumpophobic. Reactions. They're Trumpophobic. They're suffering from Trumpophobia. Trumpophobia. that fits, doesn't it? Now, he's arrogant too, okay? But he has some awareness that he's arrogant. And you could say, hey, Don, you're an arrogant SOB. He says, yeah, I know I am. Yeah, you know, it's like, okay, yeah, well, okay, so how can we do better, you know? And it's just, but I don't see, you know, I feel that there's room for repentance. I don't see him trying to crush repentance in the world, really, and claiming that men don't need to repent and that women don't need to repent. He'll go along with the tide, so to speak, but he's not going to be a crusher as far as I can see. You know, he's just like anyone. He's got feet of clay here. Feet of clay, sure. But you can talk about that. I mean, that's one thing that the feminists are so brittle, it's unbelievable. They got a lot of that from their extraterrestrial psychic adventures, really, because the ETs are super brittle. You can see the brittleness. I mean, humans are not nearly as brittle as the ETs. They're so brittle, the ETs, because they're false prophets, you know, and they know it. And anything you start criticizing them, they can't handle it at all. And the feminists are that way. You say one word of admonishment, or say, hey, wait a minute. It's like they freak out. They freak out. They completely freak out. They can't handle it. That's like the Zeta Reticulans. They can't handle any back talk at all. Like, say, hey, wait a minute. You know, who are you to evaluate me, ET? You know, Zeta Reticulan. You seem to have a lot of issues of your own here. Why don't you? You need to repent. You know, that freaks them out. Totally freaks them out. They go screaming to their reptilian masters. You know, I can't stand this. I can't stand it. I can't stand it. You know, they're insane. You know, they really are. And the feminists have caught this disease from the ETs, actually. Really, the problem we have is ETs. This is where we got this severe malady of feminism, from the ETs. They saw it as a way to take over the world. Get rid of repentant culture. If there's a repentant culture, they can't take over the world. Because we'd say, hey, who do you think you are? Get down on your knees and repent, just like we're doing. You know, you're not Jesus. Come on, who do you think you are? All right? You say, hey, reptilians, guess what? You're just a sinner just like me. And you're just an arrogant SOB, you know, just like me. Get on your knees and repent and ask the Holy Spirit to bring the grace of God upon you and show you the path to freedom from your arrogance. Well, just tell them that straight out. I don't care if there's some Draco with wings or something. I say, get on your knees and repent. That's a Christian. Would just tell them straight out. Who do you think you are? Are some goddess Draco, female reptilian with wigs, the top queen bee. I say, queen bee, get on your knees and repent. You're just a vicious, arrogant, you know, bitch, you know, you could say, and get on your knees and repent. And ask God for the grace of God to fill your heart and fill your mind and show you the path to salvation, just as Jesus told us. You don't evaluate us at all. We don't accept any of your evaluations. We accept the evaluation of Jesus Christ. This is what a Christian needs to be saying right now, okay? Now, I'm talking to other people in these videos. I'm sure there's some people from India, you know, various places around the world who are watching this. Israel, and you know, very, very, not all have Christian traditions. Some have Vajrayana Buddhist traditions, some have Hindu traditions, maybe some have Islamic traditions, etc., etc. So you know the labels to use, right? You tell them like that. Yeah, I don't care who you think you are. You have no capacity to evaluate me at all, because the disease is arrogance and you're suffering from a severe case of it. So how can you know, how can you evaluate me? You cannot. So stop even trying. So, but who is speaking this way in the world? Christians used to speak this way, as a matter of fact. They weren't as scared of any extraterrestrials. They'd say, get down on your knees and repent. I don't care if you got scales or not. That's not the issue. The issue is your arrogance. But where do you hear that? How do you, you know, are you hearing that now? No, everybody's too interested in what's the next movie coming out. I don't watch movies. At all. Holy Spirit told me to stop a long time ago, 30 years ago or so. That's it. No more. No more. No more. The vicious, vicious, vicious stuff. leading you into an attitude of non-repentance. So the world is so viciously distracted. And this attitude that feminism, it came from extraterrestrials. It came from after World War II, the severity of it actually, which is when extraterrestrials really started making contact here and influencing our culture and society through surreptitious sabotage. They're very, very good at being surreptitious and sabotaging, that it's very difficult to pin it down. Very difficult. So anybody who spoke about it, they'd say, oh, well, you prove it, you know, prove it. Well, prove to me that you have an open mind first before I spend time trying to prove anything. And you find out they don't have an open mind at all. They're phobic. They're not repentant. If you have a repentant mind, I mean, Christians are very well of quote-unquote devils and demons. They're talking about ETs, basically, and various entities, astral entities in their dimensions. There's a conglomeration of, you know, mischief makers, basically, and they know all about that. So I'm sure so the Vajrayana Buddhists, right? They know about that stuff. Very much they know about it. So, and Buddhists in general, okay, and Hindus, and people, you know, religious people have repented. They know what's going on. The feminists caught this plague, and it becomes super brittle, so beyond reproach. They're beyond reproach. If you reproach in any way, they think that you're like they're made of china and you're breaking them to pieces. Well, who has a right to be so brittle like that? Isn't that arrogance, to be so brittle? Isn't that extremely unrepentant attitude? You can't even handle, just someone, hey, mentioning, you know, that you might want to look at this, and maybe that's arrogance, and, you know, just like everyone used to do. Hey, sis, what do you think? Who do you think you are? You know, are we trying to be a glamour queen? It's ridiculous. Don't forget where you came from. Yeah, okay. You know, you could speak up. You could admonish women and men back in the day. Absolutely. Everybody admonished one another. It's amazing. Third world people, they admonish each other all the time. It's just extraordinary. It could be, seems like vicious to us, like bullying. No, they're just keeping each other in line. Then who do you think you are? You know, don't fall for this nonsense. So you start getting out of line, they start making jokes about you. Pulls you back in line like that. Say, so don't get too big for yourself. Be repentant. Accept the Dharma King's evaluation of you. Now, if they say you're doing well, then accept that with good grace and humility and keep working at it. I mean, you're supposed to do well. That's the whole idea. So, of course, you know, you're going to do better and better and better and better and better. But it's their evaluation that counts. We have a difficult time evaluating ourselves. We're so immersed in the madness of arrogance. The confusion, severe confusion. So just keep working out and let them decide what kind of shape you're in. Don't let anybody else decide what kind of shape you're in. Just keep working out. I can say work out, work out, work out. That's good. I cannot determine exactly where people are on the path. You know, no, cannot. But I can certainly determine those who are, you know, fixated or stuck, or you know, you can see. I mean, if you're like a physical trainer, you can kind of tell if people are like, you know, underdoing it or overdoing it. You know, that you're supposed to be able to tell that. Okay? So you can tell certain things, but not from a truly evaluative standpoint of where they're actually at and what their prospects are. You can't really be sure that what their prospects are. People always want to know, what are my prospects? You know, only God only knows, as they say. When will I be enlightened? You know, God only knows, really. You just don't worry about it. Just keep working at it. You know, it's like when will I be in great shape? Yeah, God only knows. You know, it's been 10 months. You know, I still am not in good shape. I'm getting in better shape, but not like I would want to be. You know, but I am getting there. I'm even starting to dance a little bit. I've never danced. Not the kind of dancing that people think about, but just, you know, it's like some of the African Americans. I realize that sometimes they're misinterpreted. Sometimes there are misinterpretations that arise. Sometimes you see them walking down the street and they're kind of moving kind of weird, and you think, oh, they're on drugs or something. Not necessarily, actually. Not necessarily. They might just be just feel like dancing. And I feel like that. If you're in really great shape, you know what? It's kind of boring to just walk along. Why don't you boogie along? Boogie on down the boulevard. Why don't you just boogie on down, you know? And why not? And some African Americans, they do this because it's cool. I understand. I understand now. It's just like, wow. Why not just shimmy a little bit? Why just plod along? You know, is that creative? You really, no, they don't really, you know, they'd rather, they come from a culture where a lot of dancing, and history is a lot of ritual dancing and stuff and moving in creative ways. So they want to move in creative ways. It doesn't make them weird. Now, they can go overboard, like we all could go overboard in various ways, you know, show off too much, but why do we have to just walk down the street? Can't we dance down the street? I started dancing, looking at people, oh, I hope nobody sees me. You know, they're crazy, they must be on drugs. Well, no, I'm not crazy, I'm not on drugs. I'm feeling pretty doggone fit. I'm able to shimmy now. I'm actually able to shimmy, I understand the shimmy. You have to have a really strong core. Of course, young people have real strong cores. They're able to do all these dances because it takes a real strong core and then very agile and relaxed body, you know, that can just allow the strong core to just, you know, to let everything else flow. Why can't we not dance down the street? This is a question. Now, maybe in the ghetto you can. Not in white suburbs you can't. I've never seen anybody dance down the street. They think you've gone mad. Well, that's crazy, isn't it? So this just shows you how bizarre, you know, it's just endless bizarreness here. It never ends, it seems like. Why can't you walk down the street singing? Everybody will assume you're on drugs. No, maybe you're happy that you're not tempted by drugs, and that's why you're singing. Joy is like, wow, the spiritual rapist cannot get me. You know, really. Feminists are spiritual rapists, actually. They really are. They're telling everybody that they're intrinsically incapable of being arrogant. What greater lie could there be, you know, than that? It's just this insane lie. Yeah, we're all bodies, we're all humans. No, we're not. Nobody's ever... Ramana said that liberation is a realization that you've never been born. Never been born. You can never be born. It's impossible. How can the self be born? How can intrinsic spaciousness be born? That's ridiculous. The idea that we're humans or bodies is utter rubbish. The humans and bodies are nothing but mental projections. They're nothing but concepts. They're nothing but concepts. The pursuit of what we already are. A fanciful, whimsical pursuit of what we already are. And it's just our creativity is just spinning this dream decoration of is all it is. It's nothing other than that. So this whole humanism is just a grotesque lie of arrogance. Repent, 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 repent. I'm sounding like John the Baptist. Just think of all the people that repented and were baptized back then, all the Jewish people start out with. They realize, hey, this self-righteous trip, that's not it. It's not it. I got to repent, and I have to follow Jesus, what he's saying to us. I got to work at it. All these rules and laws and regulations, all this kind of stuff, that's not it. Salvation's not through the law, but through grace. Yeah, we got to repent. The belief in salvation through the law is arrogance. Belief in salvation through grace is repentance. Very cut and dry and simple. And dancing, I'm realizing more like, oh, there is a way to dance without being provocative. You know, provocative dancing is horrible. I hate it. It's sickening. Our culture is so sickening, the way people dance is utterly revolting. But there's a way to dance that you just we've lost touch with it pretty much. So young people still get it to some extent. It's fun. It's just, what, you know, I can move like this and I can move like this and I'm still keep my balance. I can do this. It's just like, it's just fun. It's just fun. It's just fun. But then the whole romance thing gets into it and it ruins it. Ruins it for everybody. In the 60s, people were just grooving. They tried to take the romance out of it, but they put the drugs into it, unfortunately. It's very unfortunate. You know, nowadays young people are still trying to do that. You know, raves, you know, Grateful Dead had that tradition for a while. What was that? I don't know. You know, people would just be, you know, just moving and stuff. I can move like this and stuff. But actually, you know, that's what happens when you're out of shape. Oh, you know, white people out of shape, you know, taking drugs and going to Grateful Dead. That undermines your confidence. That's undermining your confidence. It's undermined. There's a little shimmy. Actually, just walk along and just do this little subtle little shibby. That's like, yeah, yeah. And then just a little pirouette. And it's the fluid, graceful, subtle stuff. That's really makes you feel like I'm kind of floating here. I'm not stuck. I'm not a robot, you know. I'm not a robot. And a little clap of the hand, a little clap of the hand. And just, you know, you can go into some Tai Chi sort of thing. And just, as you walk along, why not just do a Tai Chi thing as you're walking along? Why not? Why not? Because it just sort of is expressing like this intrinsic spaciousness, the fluidity that is already present. Why can't you just say, hey, you know, I'm not stuck. I'm not stuck. I'm not stuck. I'm not a robot. You don't see anybody doing that. The only people you see doing that would be African Americans, basically. And they actually helped us out by showing us you can do this. But we messed it up, and now they kind of got messed up too. It's just ridiculous what it's turned into. But there can be a graceful way, you know, to sing and to dance and. Let it be like almost like a Sufi-like thing, right? I mean, why can't we just? I do it in my vehicle now. I'm listening to music, the Beach Boys. I'll just like, why not just make this gesture? What's wrong with this gesture? Oh, what's the spiritual significance? No, no significance. Just making it is the significance because I'm free to do so. That's the significance because it's graceful. It just I just feel like expressing like this. There's no label to it. You know, no concepts. Just like Everything is perfect. I'm listening to the Beach Boys at summer, and I'm singing the heck out of it. And God be praised, you know. Grace of God be praised. Let me continue with my repentance. Could be any gesture, whatever you feel like. This is what, you know, we tried to do in the 60s, the hippies and everything. God bless all the hippies. And we've gotten so far away from it. It's just insane. Now we got these, you know, these lust-driven carnival things. I mean, this is just so perverted and so distorted and so out of whack. It's just unbelievable. The love parades and this stuff, just pathetic. It doesn't have to do with sensuality at all. It has to do with your spirit. Expressing your spirit in motion. Like, you know what, I'm free to walk backwards. I'm free to pirouette as I'm walking along. You know that? I'm 360 degreeness. So I'm like walking along. I was walking along and I just into this beautiful just spinner pirouette and I just kept walking along. Why can't we do that? Kids do it. Do they not? Watch how kids function. Aren't they spontaneous in the moment? And they'll suddenly start skipping. They go, ah, and they'll like spin around or something and clap, 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 and yeah, like that. Why can't we do that? Is there some of them passed a law that when you're adult you can't do that? Why? Because your employer will fire you, probably. So I don't want any kid working for me. Well, don't you want a super creative, super compassionate being, spiritual being, wise spiritual being working for you, who's fluid and I want robots working for me because my wife wants to remodel, you know, and so I got to make more money. And she may want to do even more and more and more and more and more because she's agitated. Well, tell her to repent and work on that instead of, you know, the other. Oh, I don't dare do that, you know. It'll crush me. I'll never hear the end of it. Well, guess what? You know, you got to start toughening up then. Everyone's under this pressure. I'm under the pressure. Everybody's under the pressure. Culturally, we're under insane pressure. It's worse than it's ever been now. By 1,000 times, really. I mean, you can't even, it's just immeasurable how bad it is actually right now. Where's Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you know, doing Sankirtana, you know, just walking down the street, just giving these beautiful, graceful gestures and dancing this beautiful divine dance. Where is that? I mean, the Hare Krishnas used to try to do that. Dancing off the tambourine, you know, down the street. You know, it was great. We didn't know what the heck was going on. It's like, what the heck? But, you know, it's like watching it, you just say, wow. There's something really cool about it. You know, it's just good for them. Good for them. Shaving their heads. They shave their heads. And just, we're just dancing ecstatically here. Good for them. Now, you don't have to go to that extreme at all. But why can't we just boogie on down the boulevard? You know, why can't we just boogie a little bit? Why not? You're moving, just, you know, you just, like you're walking, do you have to just one foot, can't you just go, can't you scoot a little bit, can't you get down a little bit, scrouch, just let me scoot along a little bit, let me like take a little hop, you know, and here's a crack on the sidewalk, let me like skip over the crack, or let me just like kind of pirouette over the crack, or, you know, the kids are looking at the sidewalk as they're walking, right? And they say, oh, there's a crack there. There's a, right? Let me hop here and do this. And it's like they're having fun. They're having fun walking down the sidewalk. When was the last time you had fun walking down the sidewalk? Where are these commandments? What kind of commandments are we following here? Except efficiency and roboticism. So the unrepentant can project their agitation onto materialism. Say, I need some new materialism here. Make it happen, Buster. Because I'm really pissed, you know? I'm really agitated. And you're the cause of it. You know, just, come on, fix it for me. I better stop dancing. You know, I better get to work, give a robot more efficiency. Come on, robots, work. This is the insane culture that the hippies were worried about, and they were right. We had premonitions, we had intuitions. This is what's going on. This is what's where it's going. They tried to prevent it. Didn't work. But you know, it's better to have tried and failed than not have tried at all. Better to have loved and lost than not have loved at all, as the poet would say it. But you know what? At least I'm aware of it because of that. I'm saying, hey, this is what we were worried about right now. I mean, do you have to keep walking in a linear fashion? Can you not, like, put it in reverse? Like, you walk along and suddenly you can do like a stop and a little moonwalk backwards and then go forward. Why do we have to keep going in a forward motion, forward path all the time? Or how can we just like break it to the side? You walk along a sidewalk, just kind of like, you know, just kind of like a little dance move to the side, and then just, you know, then go for another dance to the side. Why do we have to keep just one step after they're going forward? Can we break it to the side a little bit? I'm working on it. I'm pounding those stairs, you know? Getting the strength in the legs and the core. I'm really hitting it hard on the core. Wow. And it's helping me. I'm starting to be able to make moves now. Dance moves side to the side. I'm walking, I can just shift to the side and just do this little, you know, it's like, wow, how'd I do that? So I don't know. It was just like I never even thought about it. Has anyone ever thought about you walking down the street and you just do a little move to the side? When's the last time you saw anybody do that? When it just someone might just goes, hey, you know, and just, you know, just like let me just turn like 90 degrees. Okay, you're walking forward. Turn like 90 degrees. Turn 90 degrees and just go off to the side and lean against a building or something, and just say yes. And then swim back into the sidewalk like this, and then start walking again. Yeah. Why not? Why not put a little delight into your day by doing that? You can't do a nice 90-degree pivot and boogie up to and lean against a building and just stop and then swim back. Why not? Or why don't you go on the side? Why don't you swim? Say, hey, yeah, I'm swimming, man. Yeah, and you know, point out, parody, show everybody. Hey, you know, do you really want to be roboticized? Is that the answer to arrogance, or is it repentance that's the answer to arrogance? So it's not just this strict, you know, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. No, it's more creative than that. Why don't you just swim down the sidewalk, you know, with your arms and your body? You could be do, 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 do. Or you know, like pulling a rope, like, ah, I'm just like pulling a rope here. Ah, yeah, it's just difficult. Yeah. Or like you're going through a forest, you know, ah, like this, ah, yeah. Brushing all the foliage away as you go through. And people are walking towards you like, oh, yeah, oh, your foliage, you know, I got to go ride like this. People think you're insane if you do that. You're not insane. You're being creative. You're being spiritually expressive. They should laugh and say, yeah. It's like, yeah, yeah, hey. And then I see like, they might start it doing it too, you know, like, hey. And the black African-Americans are more hip to this. And we think that they're somehow inferior because of this or something. We put them down because of this. I'm not trying to lionize anybody, but I'm just saying that if you did that to an African-American, they might say, yeah, you know, oh, yeah, I see what you do. I'm hip too, man. I got that. You know, yeah, I got that. You know, and they're not going to say you're crazy. You're not going to say you're crazy, you know. And I say, no, you're hip. I gave this homeless African-American something, you know, and he was listening to the music, and he suddenly goes, oh yeah. He says, oh, I like that groove, man. And he starts just kind of this little shimmy and stuff. And I say, yeah, you got it, man. You got it. I said, keep on grooving, man. Keep on grooving. I didn't think he was crazy for doing that. I said, oh, he must be on drugs. Oh, whoa, turn, you know, put the window up. I said, yeah, man, that's a good reaction to the beautiful music. But what? But he must be a statue or something. I got a statue walking down the street. What are we, statues walking on legs or something? What the heck is going on in this world, actually? Well, we know. It's the play of arrogance. Let's automate and roboticize our arrogance. So we're not prone to repentance. You know, how can a robot repent? So we're being taught to be robots by these, you know, feminists who claim that their advice is not coming from arrogance, although they haven't repented at all. Of course it's coming from arrogance. So it's a very bad, bad thing to follow the advice of arrogance. Terrible. Terrible. Follow the advice of the Dharma kings. Take your pick. You don't like one, or you feel more comfortable with one or the other, fine. Just find one and follow their advice. Follow the advice ultimately of the Holy Spirit. If you don't want to find a Dharma king, just follow the advice of the Holy Spirit then. You have to repent. Have to repent. So, but I'm jumping rope. I'm jumping. The Holy Spirit told me, you got to learn to jump. This was a while back, maybe 6 months or 7 months ago. I've been jumping ever since, and I'm getting better and better and better at it. Hopping. I mean, hopping. He says, you got to be hopping. You got to know how to hop. You got to. I said, what? Jump rope? Are you kidding? I can't jump rope. One, two, oh, I can't do it. You know, every single person I've told to jump rope, no, not a one has done it. Not a one. Nobody. And I've told a lot of people, you said, really, you should try this. It's really important. Nobody has done it. They're roboticized. They all say, oh, it's a really good idea. Do any of them follow through? Not a one. Not that I know of. Not a one. This is incredible. I mean, you're supposed to be desperate. Those who repent are desperate because they know how wicked arrogance is. There's nothing wrong with being desperate. In fact, you should be desperate. For those whose house is burning down should feel a sense of desperation. I got to get out of this house right now. That's desperation. It's a very positive emotion, desperation, in that way. We're desperate. And when you're desperate, you listen to the Holy Spirit. Those who are trying to play it too cool don't listen to the Holy Spirit. So they say, oh yeah, jump rope, that's really great. Oh, it's a great, yeah, I know, it's a great exercise. Well, do you do it? Oh, no. Really, no, I was a kid, I used to do it, yeah. But see, they say, oh, I'm not a kid anymore. Really? Well, why are we bragging that we're not kids anymore? Why should we be bragging about that? I'm an adult. Is that some statement of greatness or something? Or does it mean I'm very roboticized now? And I'm pleasing arrogance by doing that. What's wrong with being a kid? I mean, so I did it as a kid. So they think, well, if I do it now, people think I'm trying to be a kid or something. Well, what's wrong with trying to be a kid? Are kids stupid? I wasn't stupid when I was a kid. I was brilliant, as most kids are. They look at a stone. They don't see a stone. They see, okay, what do I want that stone? What do I want to be? It's a castle. Okay, this is the castle, folks. You know, and this tree, what's that tree? You know, it says, okay, well, that's a spaceship or something, you know. Right? Their minds are fluid. They realize all this stuff is just projections, mental projections anyway. So they're just sort of, I'm just, you know, idealizing it all. But again, what's wrong with being a kid? What's wrong with skipping rope? I know people think I'm a little odd. We skip rope? Really? You don't? Oh, it's great. But, you know, why are you skipping rope? You're 60. Why are you skipping rope? Actually, I'm moving better now than I ever have. Because I never worked out like this before. Yeah, that wasn't cool. That wasn't cool. What are you trying to be? Yeah, adults don't do it like that. Adults, we lift the weights, you know, you know, something. But skipping rope, hopscotching down the sidewalk. Why can't, you see, kids, they hopscotch down the sidewalk. Why can't we hopscotch down the sidewalk? What's wrong with that? They see the squares on the sidewalk. Their imagination says, hey, I see a game here. Hop, 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 hop. Oh, I landed on a crack. Can't do that. You know, they make up games. They're constantly making up games as they go along. I mean, how do they do that? They're just always making up these wonderful little games. And when the game, you know, something else, poof, game's gone. Because their imagination says, I can make up whatever I want to make up. They're fabulous at making up games. Everything, they could just kids go play, let's go play, you know, let's make up games. Okay, this is this, before you know it, they're all playing a game. Don't show off. Now, I know my golf swing now is just like powerful. Do I go out and play golf? No. Just keep working on it. Just make it stronger. Just make it stronger. Don't show off. Make it stronger. The side benefits are enormous. It's not about showing off. So when I walk, I try not to walk anymore. I try to move in creative ways. Move to your car, you know. You walk into car from your grocery store. Don't just plod. You know, you know, go boom. Now I'm at the car. I'm in the car. I'm getting in the car. Don't just sway. Get in. Go. Open the door like boom, and then get in the car. Go whoosh. You know, whoosh and pa pa pa. Okay, I'm not ready to go. So let's put this little the pizzazz. You know, pizzazz in what you're doing. Put the radio on, oh, you know, Beach Boys, oh, You know, I don't say, oh, Beach Boy song, I gotta sing. No, I go, put up my arm, testify, testify, yeah. All right. Ooh, yeah, you know, you know, put your hands together like this. Why can't you walk down the street and just like this, you know? Do you ever see anybody walking down the street like this? We immediately assume they're on some severe drug trip. Crazy, huh? Why don't we walk down the street like just... We don't have to, like, bow to everybody. I mean, okay, let them walk, do what they're doing, but why can't we just walk like, just blessings to everyone, blessings to everyone. Or just walk down the street like this, just... Or like this, just walk down the street like this. Walk down the street like this. Now, why can't you do that? Why can't you, you know, why can't we do that? Now, this is not attempt to spiritualize concepts at all. So be careful. The yoga girls will might train say, oh yeah, okay, we'll show you how to do this or something. You know, be careful of that. There's always this fine line. Understand this fine line. For you, it's just spontaneous. You're not trying to ritualize anything. Okay. Stay in the now of your own spontaneity, of your own grace, of your own wowness. Stay in the grace of your own wowness. Don't be overly concerned about it. But, you know, everyone has to use their own discernment, right? So there's no substitute for that. It's better that there's some older guy, conservative older guy doing it than some, you know, yoga babe, you know, 20-something yoga babe teaching you that, because there's a lot of other issues that enter into the picture, actually, that they're very tempting, and it's easy to move it into, hey, let's spiritualize concepts, you know, that kind of thing. Absolutely it is. And, you know, because our default here is arrogance and mother knows best, thinking that we're bodies. And so we think, oh, it's we just automatically then default to mom knows best and women know best, and I need to do what they tell me to do. Their evaluation of me is accurate, so they know how to advise me, obviously. If they can evaluate me clearly, then they must know how to give me right advice, so thus I should follow it. You know, I need to do what they do. No, you do your own thing. As this is what the sixth says, do your own thing. This came from a lot of spiritual grace at that time. Do your own thing. Don't mimic what I'm doing or take classes. I got to move like this. I got to move like that. You know, you could do that to get fit, but do your own thing. Do your own thing. There's plenty you can do. Just walk down the street. You just might, you know, just you might just stop. Raise your hand up. You see anybody stop and just raise their hand up like this? And they might be then clapping. Yeah! And then you start walking again. Because they're expressing their freedom. Right? Do your own thing. This is the hippies. You know? Wow. Return of the hippies. Maybe this is the return of the hippies. Maybe not. I think a lot of them are burned out. Unfortunately. Oh boy. 1 second here. No, I'm just going to crush the call. Well, I'll just let it ring. I just have to say taping, you know. Yeah, let me do that quickly. I don't even know how to do it. Yeah, bap, bap, bap. I don't know. How do you do that? I don't even know. 1 second here. It's not really on my mind, but as you're doing your smartphone thing, or whatever, you know, just boogie with that too, okay? So you send it, just go, you know, oh, I just said it, oh. goes, you know, and here it comes back. I always know what, not always, but I can, we can all know when something's coming in. We know. I sent someone a message, condolences message a couple of days ago, and they didn't respond. For a long time, I was wondering, wow, maybe something's wrong with them. It probably, and then suddenly they said, oh, no, I think they're gonna. I think they're responding now. I think they're responding now, and then just a little bit later, like about 5 to 10 seconds later, boom, the text came in. I was aware that they were texting me. They were sending me, absolutely aware of it. Mind is one. You see people like in India, Tibet, stuff, they're rolling down the sidewalk, they're rolling down the road, they're prostrating, they're doing, you know, on pilgrimages, they do all sorts of stuff, and nobody pays any attention to them. People can dance down, you know, the road. Here, are you kidding? I think there's too much German organization here or something, or, you know, Anglo-Saxon efficiency or whatever, you know, the whole thing. Asiatic efficiency, the Chinese, Japanese, I mean, they don't do that. What's that? But we're not, you know, we're not showing off discoing or anything. It's just be yourself. Be yourself, as they said. Be yourself. Charger did the stupid thing. It is so stupid. Phones are so stupid. They really are. They're just terrible. I can't figure out how to set the one-touch dialing. I figured it out before. Now I spent like half an hour. Couldn't find it. Could not find it. It's crazy. That's the most important thing for me. I don't care about anything else. I just want to press a number like 4, hold it down, and that dials somebody. Because you do that while driving, right? That's how you dial when you're driving. It's the most important feature, and they bury it so you can't even find it. It's just ridiculous. They have all this other stuff I never use. 99% of the stuff on the phone I never use. The one thing I want to use is one-touch dialing and be able to change if I need to, and you can't find it. It's like completely upside down and backwards. You know, morons. Really. It's amazing. Very elusive. The stuff you want is very elusive. They want to, you know, just their mindset is just upside down and backwards. But kids are schlepping along now, you know, with their smartphone. Say, hey, you know, or what do you see people, hey, tree, you know, nice to see you this morning. I can see you're just loving the day as much as I am. Hey, flower, thank you for your beauty, you know. Yes, 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 yes. All praises. Thank you so much for your beauty. Bird. Oh, there's these birds yesterday, this morning came out. I said, wow, the birds just put on this show for me. It was so awesome. I said, thank you, birds. Like, good morning. I see the birds say, good morning, bird. Thank you for showing up. How's the day going with you? Yeah. And the bird's like looking at me like this. And they get it, you know. If you're broadcasting at some level, they get it, and then the birds are hopping, hop, hop, hop. They come flying in, and they're hopping. And I say, I love you, birds. Thank you. You're putting on a great show, because I love birds. They're so free. It's like suddenly, poof, you know. And then, da, pa, pa, poof, 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 poof. You know, just to see, like, they seem to be able to go any direction, anywhere, just instantly, and just fly right through trees and go anywhere. It's like, wow, man, it'd be cool to be a bird, wouldn't it? Would it not be? They just seem to be instant, spontaneously free. So, yeah, why can't we just say good morning, bird? Nobody does that. Good morning, tree. Good morning, atmosphere. I'm here. I am moving in here. You know, I am absolutely boogieing through the day in this glorious atmosphere, man. Dance with me. You know, dig my dance. Does anyone do that? No. What happened? Why not? We used to. But what, we got became too sophisticated for that? Or have we lost our sophistication through materialism? Through the junk television and movie junk. Okay, junk culture. Turn us all into robots, sheeple, easily controlled. P- people used to comment on fashion. They walk in and say, "Oh, okay. Why?" Okay, and wears some hat. Hi, all right. And you know, you spin your hat around or something, or tip your hat, you know, and oh, that fashion. And everybody was just, you know, just kind of flowing with it's all just vibration and light, really. But do we do that nowadays? No, people don't even make eye contact anymore. Yoga girls always like, "Oh, you make eye contact with me, don't you dare." Or if you do, make sure it's subservient. Make sure it's subservient. I don't even pay attention to them anymore. Like they don't just walk right past, like they're not even there. You know, because it's hostile. It's hostile. It's hostile. Yeah, because they're provocative. They're trying to control you. Want to see, are you a good little slave? You know, do you have a good little slave attitude? I say, well, you know, it's not for you to evaluate what my attitude is. I'll let the Holy Spirit evaluate it. Don't let them in, don't be intimidated. They try to call you sexist or something. You say, "Oh, I'll let the Holy Spirit evaluate me, what I'm all about, not you, not any, not the, not arrogance. I'll let the Holy Spirit just be the arbitrator of what I am, where I'm at, and where I need to do, what I need to work on, because you know why? It'll be accurate, and arrogance is never accurate. So I want accuracy." They'll say, "Well, we'll be really nice to you." I don't want niceness. We'll be really mean to you then. I don't want meanness. I want accuracy. Holy Spirit will be accurate. Holy Spirit will be absolutely spot on accurate, and help us, you know, evaporate the continuity fear, what we need to evaporate. Absolutely. And again, do your own thing. It's never about the romance. It's never about the special dance, and your special relationship. It's never about the seduction. It's never about that. No. It's just about, you know, you're driving your car. You see the low riders, they're grooving it. They're grooving it. You know, it's just like, this is, I'm doing my thing. I'm not a robot. You know, I'm. This is why the cultures have like low riding. There's things where I said, you know what? I'm riding and I'm just like, I'm styling. I feel like holding the steering wheel like this. You know, I'm not like, you know, like this. I'm a robot. I feel, I'm going to hold it like this. You know, I'm just, you know, I'm going to just say, look. You don't control me. You don't tell me what to do. I'm not a robot. This hideous efficiency mania, America is this, in a lot of countries, China, Japan, you name a lot of westernized countries or materialistic countries, it's all about efficiency. Materialistic efficiency. And you're just supposed to be serving that efficiency and making it even better. It's insane. I mean, that these people should be in mental institutions, actually. This world is a mental institution, actually. But the idea that we're all, this is what our lives are supposed to be like, these people are suffering from severe mental problems, arrogance, actually. You know, guess what? We don't need your stuff. Do we need your stuff to boogie down the street? No, we don't. Hippies, they just bought you know, thrift store clothes. Go in, get a shirt for, you know, 25 cents. T-shirt says something on the front, whatever. We don't need all your materialism to be happy. Fact, we need to drop concepts to be happy. Drop labels. Drop doing anything. Drop all pursuit of what we are. It's the only way. Stop trying to find truth to be it. Stop trying to be truth in order to realize you already are truth. Why are we trying to be what we already are? Trying to be? Stop trying to be. You see guys, third world types of people, they hanging around a car or something, and they'll just like break into little dances, and people, they'll laugh, oh yeah, and they'll hear a song on the radio, whatever, their CD, and they'll just break into a little dance there, and guys, people be clapping, and say, oh yeah, why not, why not, why not, have a good laugh, it's free, Isn't it free to move your arms yet, right? But no, everything here has to be, have a monetary value on it. You can't tax that. They'll tax dancing. I'm sure they'll tax everything. So we just expended, you just increased your breath output by dancing, so that adds to the carbon deficit or something. So we'll tax your dancing or your singing. We'll tax your singing. Got to be all monitored. They'll have devices on our wrist that monitor our heartbeat, and they'll extract from that what our breath, your pulse, and what your breath rate is, and everything. And then they'll tell you how to be more robotic. Yeah, the robots are taking over here. Goodbye, goodbye. Auf Wiedersehen. Take out your handkerchief. You see. Take out a handkerchief as you go down the sidewalk. Auf Wiedersehen, just to the air, to the atmosphere, to the gestalt of the whole thing. Not taking it. Not doing it. Not doing it. Goodbye, little lizards, little unrepentant lizards. Have fun slithering around here. And it's not about like dance marathons or just trying to be drive yourself in a frenzy, shamanistic frenzy. No, not at all. Not at all. We got way too much of that drug. When drugs enter the picture, the whole thing goes off the tracks. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, it goes off the tracks. You get too frenzied, you get too worked. No, it's just about how do you walk to your car from the hardware store. Today I was thinking, how do you do it? I start skipping. No, people don't want me to skip. And so I just kind of like put a little boogie in my walk, a little shimmy in my walk. I just kind of shimmy to the car. I said, I wonder if anybody's looking. If they did, they think I'm like a little bit nuts. I said, well, I'm a very presentable nuts, though. I'm a presentable nut. I did not overdo it, but you can't do. You feel the cultural disapproval is insane right now. It's the worst it's ever been. They'd say, we better get him a smartphone. I think he needs a smartphone. He needs a smartphone, but it's a smartphone. You got to learn how to be a good little robot. After all, that's the future. Whose future? It's the future of arrogance. It's not the future of repentance at all. I'm following my future. My future is a future coming from repentance. Okay? So I'm just boogieing into my future, or into my nowness. I'm just boogieing into my nowness. We all abide in our own nowness. My voice is terrible. It's tired. I don't know. It's weird. Trying to sing the higher Beach Boys songs. I've lost my honky tonk voice. I got to see if I can even sing honky tonk again. It's weird. And I can't sing high anymore. It's like, wow, crazy. So I'm. But again, working out, it's tired, it's strained, and once it gets its second wind, third wind stuff, then I'll be able to pump it out. The same with singing. Why do you have to sing the root? Sing the harmony. Why do you have to stay on the third? Jump to the fifth. Go to the third to fifth, third to fifth, third to fifth root, and then shift down. Go to the sixth or something, and then just go off key if you want, just for fun. Why do you have to sit there and just plod along on the root? Plod along, we plod along on the sidewalk. We plod along with our words, right? I gotta say this, and I gotta say this, and I gotta say this, and I gotta say a sentence. Why? Can't we just say, yeah? Trust it. Trust it. Why can't we say, talking to someone, just say, trust it. And they can't, why can't they just say silent, just nod, just yeah. That was the 60s, that's what we did. Trust it. Right on, right on, right on. And they could just shimmy away. It was all good. Nobody took offense. I said, wait a minute, you're not being efficient, robotic here. What's going on? My standard of living. I need a new car. No, right on, right on, right on. We could speak poetically. When's the last time you heard someone speak poetically and socially? I did it just a while ago. People said, what? Huh? I'd be afraid. Oh, I can't do that. You know? Now we used to speak poetically. I guess that's what's rapping is, kind of a way of trying to break free. But it's gotten so absurd, you know. It's all the junk has got into it. And that itself has become robotic, you know. But why can't we just be poetic in some way? Or not say anything at all? Just be silent. That's the ultimate statement, is it not? The anti-corporate statement, just be silent. Just sit there and don't do anything. That'll really freak the corporate fascist feminist mindset out, to totally freak them out. No, no, no. We didn't evaluate you that way. We didn't give you permission to do nothing. Said, well, the Holy Spirit did. You're not in charge of evaluating me at all. You're incompetent. Totally incompetent. 100% incompetent at it. So give it up. Get on your knees and repent right now. You sinner, you terrible sinner. Yeah. See, we've gotten away from that. We think, oh, that's bad, liberal, you know, the psychiatrist. They said, no, you're not sinners. We've got to build your self-esteem up. No, the more we avoid facing our arrogance and the more we avoid repentance, the less our self-esteem becomes. And this is what we're all suffering from, self-esteem crisis, which is why there's so much conflict in the world. Nobody can boogie down the street. Nobody has the self-esteem to do it anymore. This whole craziness that the liberals are building our self-esteem, they're tearing it to pieces. They're tearing it to pieces. Our real self-esteem comes from repentance. As soon as you repent, you'll feel some newfound self-esteem. Like, whoa, I'm not nearly as terrible as I thought I was. Wow, I'm actually fabulous. You just fundamentally, you'll feel different in a subtle way. You just immediately have some confidence that you didn't thought you'd never find again. As soon as you repent, you feel that. Oh my gosh, what happened? I'm a changed being. I'm a spiritual being. Oh my gosh, I was just pretending to be this robotic moron of a human being. Wow. We're not trying to be hippies. If you try to be a hippie, you're not a hippie. You see? You're not hip at all. If you're trying to be hip, you're not hip. Just get in shape. That's hip. Get in spiritual shape. Get in physical shape. Get in all 360-degree shape. That is hip, you know? And it's do your own thing. Do your own thing. And that can very well be, if someone suggests, like I might suggest, you know, do this, you know, watch this, do this, practice like this. Well, yeah. I mean, if someone, a trainer says, well, you know what, sidestep and do these sidestep things, that'll really help you. And you say, oh, thanks. Yeah, they'll do that. I saw someone doing doubles. I said, oh my God. Yeah, I can. Let me try doing doubles. Sure. So if someone is good at suggesting, by all means, do it. Again, trying to be a hippie is not a hippie. So try and say, oh, no, I don't follow anybody, what do they say, or you know, I don't really, that's trying too hard. No. It's having your own will, you know, following your inner spirit, the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit says, hey, check this out. Check it out. Hey, this'll work for you. Do it. Oh, okay, thank you. Thank you. You know, we're not robotically counterculture or robotically this or anything. Either way, right? We're not either good or bad. We're perfect. So we're just kind of hopping with perfection. We do a little bird hop. Why can't we walk like a bird walking out? Do a little bird hop. Do you see a bird hop? Why don't you hop? Why not? Is this a nod to the birds? Hey, yeah, I saw the hop. As a matter of fact, I was in a store today, and I started shuffling my feet back and forth. That's an exercise I highly recommend to help your nimbleness. You can do it anywhere unobtrusively. On the balls of your feet, you just wiggle your feet back and forth like this, and you can actually move this way. You find that you start moving backwards actually, and I was doing that in the store. Just There's a bunch of people everywhere. And this very alert guy at the counter, a Christian, says, "Ah, how are you, Dorothy?" He says, "I see you, Dorothy." He said, "I see you, Dorothy." Meaning Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz clicking her heels together like this. See, he saw it and he spoke up about it. I said, "Very observant, man. Awesome, awesomely observant." And he had the humor to speak up about it. He said, "Yeah." And he didn't judge you for it. He's laughing. He says, I see you're moving there. I see you're moving." He said, "Ah." Right? See, it's very cool, right? That's coolness right there. That's being hip. That's being hip. He was spiritually hip. And I said, "Oh yeah, I'm a wizard. I'm really, I'm clicking my heels. I'm moving. You saw it. I'm moving. I am grooving." Everyone else was just standing there like, I said, "Why should I just stand there? We're waiting to be waited on. Why should I just stand like everybody else, like zombied out on their smartphones, like, I got to do something. Everybody just immediately gets out the smartphone. Any like waiting thing, now it's a social thing. Especially the women. It's unbelievable. The guys too, but the women. Doctor's office, immediately come in, first thing, you know. What the heck? You know, why not like get up and say, "Ah, look at that painting. What do you think about that painting? What do you see? Rorschach test. What do you see?" Why do we just sit there like zombies, like we don't know each other? Like we some are all separate minds or something. Like, "Oh yeah, I'm special. My mind's separate." You know, just, really? Wow. This culture is so uptight. It's insane. It is totally insane. Or just doctor's office. It's such a bummer just sitting there. Is it not? Everybody's all frozen up there. And I try to break the ice. Everybody's like, defensive, you know, like, "Yeah, I don't want to." Our folks are sitting in the doctor's office. Come on. And I say, "Ah, we're in a doctor's office," right? And everybody can say, "Ah." Everybody should just say, yeah, "I'm here for my, you know, I'm pre-surgical thing." No. Everybody's like, isolated, like cubicles, you know, we're like invisible cubicles. Where are these? Oh, hello. Oh, I hit my head, you know, on that cubicle or something. How are you doing? Ouch. What's wrong? Well, I hit my head on this invisible cubicle. I don't see it. Well, it's invisible, but it's there, is it not? I mean, how do you loosen up the world? How do you, the hippies tried, but they brought in a lot of drugs to do it, unfortunately. And people said, you know, it messed everything up. God gave it a bad name now. Can't do it with drugs. Cannot. And actually, the hippies were subverted by corporate culture. The truth of the matter is, is it was intentionally done subverting the hippies. The real hippies didn't need drugs. They were counterculture, actually. They didn't want to be robots, is all. And what happened was corporate culture, through the chemists and all this kind of stuff, their whole apparatus, military-industrial complex, global corporate culture, intentionally brought the drugs in, distributed them, helped distribute them, made sure, and subverted the whole thing. They subverted the whole thing. Subverted black culture also, African-American culture. Cocaine, bringing in drugs, they subverted it. It was intentionally done because that was counterculture too. I mean, they weren't robots. African Americans don't like being robots, and so all this drugs were brought in, and it's proven. It's proven this was done, and so they're right. I mean, it was intentionally trying to destroy black culture through drugs, distributing them and protecting the pushers and all of this stuff. It's all done on purpose. Terrible things have happened. Corporate culture strikes back very viciously because they want robots. They want to control you. What do they want? They want to know. They want to tell you what to buy and when to buy it and how much to buy of it, plain and simple. And then you do exactly as they tell you to do. That's their dream of happiness. They say, "This is how we can be happy." That's what arrogance tells them. That's why they're monitoring everything you do on the computer. They have a massive data file on everybody. As soon as you look up anything, suddenly all the advertisements pop up everywhere. It says, "This is what you're interested in. We know what you're interested in." They're profiling everybody. But it's got all messed up now because of all the drugs and everything. Is there's a lot of troubles, and it's become nasty and terrible and this agitated, right? As we said in the 60s, free your mind. You know, free your body, free your mind. Don't just walk down the sidewalk like a corpse. Don't just sit there like a corpse. And they, of course, started wearing outlandish clothes. Don't be just this corporate corpse. Listening to outlandish music. You know, don't just be this romantic, you know, corporate corpse. romanticizing, you know, four kids in a bedroom house in the suburbs. Don't romanticize being a corpse. They want social engineers. The corporation wanted to be social engineers and engineer society. Of course they do. Of course they do. Got to be aware of it. I mean, if you're a business person, how can you blame them? But you got to be aware of that. Absolutely, they do. They're ferociously after that. So, and so, again, but the response cannot be robotic either. You got to do your own thing. Wow, your own grace. Wow, your own grace. And at the same time, always listen to the Holy Spirit and follow its advice. So you're not trying to just say I'm independent of God. No. Independent of grace. No, we need to masterfully evaporate our continuity fear. You have to be brilliant about it. So of course you listen to the guru. Of course. And you don't say, well, I got to do my own thing, so I'm not going to do what you say. No, like today, I got to say, I got to do my own thing. And do doubles. No. I said, I hear what you're saying. Okay, you got it. I'll follow your advice. The Holy Spirit is acting in our best interest. So there's no corporateness there just because we follow the Holy Spirit's advice. Not at all. The Holy Spirit is not roboticizing us, just the opposite. It's freeing our mind to absolute freedom in all directions. 360 degree absolute freedom, boogieing in all directions always. Shimmying in all directions always, in terms of the feeling it's always there. The shimmy in all 360 degree shimmy is always present, right? The swimming, the fruit, we're swimming, you know, just we're twisting in 360 degree twisting in all directions, 360 degree. Yeah. So by all means, pay attention to that grace which is helping us evaporate our continuity fear. Practicing no practice, practicing the dropping of practice, making efforts to drop all effort, you know, full stop in the wow, no labels, dropping all labels, all concepts, flipping the script, making assertions, wowing our grace. By all means, do that. Do it like you're working out. You have to become very spiritually fit, right? And this is what I've been preaching. We got to be very spiritual fit now, or else there's going to be a situation will arise where you'll overcompensate and show off, and that's the hook. They'll set the hook in your spirit, and you're hooked, and you'll fixate, and you'll become that robotic moron that you hoped you wouldn't ever be. You know, you'll act that out. Your creativity will act that out as the framework of your pursuit of what you already are, actually. That spiritual blindness. Of course, if we're pursuing what we already are, we're blind to what we are. Already are. Of course. So you'll get hooked in the framework of your pursuit. There's like a frame. The picture is empty. There's no picture, but we're working on the frame. We're building this frame. We think if we get the frame just right, the picture will be there of crystallization, of changed reality, of catching ourselves. But it's really just an empty frame. Is all there is. This is just the whole world. It's all empty, as the Buddha says. It's all an empty frame. It's just an empty frame, actually. but we're working frantically on that frame. The frame of futility. Gotten to be 90 today. It feels cold. It's like, oh, it's too cool. Come on, give me, I'm on 95. Come on. I see these techies now. You know, I look at them. I say, am I looking at a person or am I looking at a slug? It looks like there's slugs sliming along the street. What? The way they look, the way they move. What is this? Snail? A slug? When's the last time you saw someone walking on the sidewalk singing about Jesus? Probably it's been 30, 40 years. I remember the Jesus freaks used to do that. Jesus, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. You're walking down the sidewalk singing Jesus. Wow, how cool would that be? Fabulous. Let's hear it. Go past the Apple store singing about Jesus. They probably think he just came from Mars. And as a matter of fact, they're the ones that actually came from Mars. But they say, yeah, but this is our planet now. You know? I say, well, yeah, maybe we'll go to Mars then. Or actually, we'll go to Jesus' dwelling place, which is a lot better than Mars. So you may just wow it. You say, "Oh my gosh, yeah, this culture. What has happened? How crazy is this? It's so crazy we can't even get wrap our minds around it. But we're kind of doing that here." And so again, it's your fitness, your spiritual fitness is absolutely essential. And so I can lead a horse to water. I can't make a horse drink. So I try to do everything. All these videos are to help our spiritual fitness. It's just work out. Just like, it's very similar to physical fitness. Very similar. Yeah, today I do the legs, tomorrow the core, next day the upper body. Some days I do all four. Flexibility, the four. The legs, the core, the upper body, and flexibility. Do all of them. And every day I'm doing something. Every single day, I'm hitting it hard. I'm really hammering it. Same thing with spiritual fitness. Every day you really hammer it. I do. I really do. So what am I going to do tonight? You see, this is already on my mind. After I tape this, what's the next workout? It's like that. Be a fitness fanatic, a spiritual fitness fanatic, without overdoing it. Absolutely, this is what you should be. You should really be in a crash course now of getting spiritually fit. That should have been the last year. I gave a heads up to everybody. For years, I've been giving a heads up. And I said, now you know, 24th of July this year is a drop dead date. You better not be out of shape by that time. So still, whatever you can do, do it. Watch the videos. I mean, I'm making them for that purpose. The Darshan Dharma King Darshan is for your workout. It's a workout. These videos are designed to be a workout. And when you get through them, you should be more fit. You should, wow. Now, initially, you'll feel tired, you'll be stressed, you know, wow. Yeah. But down the road, you look like this month or last month. You, like I said, like steps, I can hammer the steps now. Like, it's amazing how much better I've gotten. I say, wow, I'm so much better than I used to be. It's amazing. But from moment to moment, day to day, you know, I feel like, oh, am I really getting it? I feel like I feel tired. I feel stupid. No, that's the wow. That's the wow. Same with physical workouts. You feel tired. I feel really tired right now. I try to pick up the weights and, oh my God, I feel so weak. I said, yeah, but I just pressed like twice as much as before, twice as many reps today as I did 4 days ago. So how is it that I'm getting weaker? I'm not. It's just that after a workout you feel weak and tired, right? Of course. So again, transfer your experience with fitness to the spiritual path and just use the same wisdom that you have. The same wisdom. Yeah, I feel spiritually weak right now. Well, because I really had a great workout. So guess what? Tomorrow I'll bounce back. If not tomorrow, the next day, I'll keep doing little stuff. Keep doing little stuff. And let me exercise this. I haven't, you know, this part still feels good. I can exercise this. I can watch this video. I can watch this. I can do that. I can do a Darshan video and just groove it. Just say, yeah. As you're watching it, just say, yes. Don't say, okay, what do I got to do? I'm a robot. I got to be a spiritual robot. How do I do this? No. Just, wow. You know, if you're stuck, just wow it. That's always an exercise. It completely frees you from being stuck. I'm not stuck at all. It restores your confidence too. When you just, I can wow it. I don't have to have labels for it. Oh, you know, this guru is so nice. How do I label it? No, just wow. I'm feeling it. I'm working out. Wow, what a workout. What a great workout. Yes. Don't label it. Just wow it. Don't label it. Just wow it. Just feel it. You can say, it's a great workout. Just, yeah. Like, you're doing great. Tell yourself, I'm doing great. Wow, I'm doing great with this. Wow. Don't think, okay, what is this doing? What is this? No, it's getting us in fitness. It's interesting how it converges, and like I said, it's suddenly converging for me to be able to kind of boogie, you know, shimmy. And I said, wow, where'd that come from? I don't know. I could do it now. I never even thought of that. I just boogie like, I'm just sure. I said, whoa, where did that come from? Well, overall fitness suddenly converges and you find yourself moving in ways that you didn't even think of before. Same with spiritual fitness, you find yourself dropping concepts in a way you never thought you could. Wowing, you know, glimpsing the truth in ways you never thought you could. Your mind seems so much freer than before. And you say, how did that happen? Well, it's just a general convergence is how it happened. So you keep on working this angle of spiritual fitness, work this angle, work this, keep working these angles. That's all I do, basically. Pretty much all I've done with my whole life is just work these different angles and convergence. So again, don't be plodding along that sidewalk necessarily. You may watch a video, but watch it creatively. Don't freeze up, or if you could freeze up also. That's also creative. I just want to just like don't move at all. That's fine too. But don't make it robotic. You feel that you're wowing it. This is how you want to wow it. That's how you wow it. But stay in the wow. How are we doing on this video? We're moving right along, aren't we? It's been an outpouring here. As it should be. I sang a lot today. My voice is fried for singing. What can I do? I don't know. Just... Let it bounce back. let it recover. I've been eating a lot more than before, put on a couple pounds. Because I don't want to, you know, don't overdo it as far as dieting. So carrying a little extra weight, but not too much, and you know, I'm watching it. Gone pretty easy today, but I ate a big pasta starch meal last night. First time I've done that in a long time. Yeah, why not? Okay, they'll have some of that. It was a heavy big meal, so that probably put on 2 pounds right there. It was heavy, very heavy, weight-wise. After the workout today, I got the Body Armor Tropical Punch, electrolyte sports recovery drink. Poured that all in there. Then I poured a whole bunch of tart red cherry juice in there. Then I poured a whole bunch of fresh lemon juice, and then lime juice, and then chocolate protein powder. And then I just Nutribolted it up, chugged it down. Right after working out, and so you know, doing just practical, smart stuff like that helped me recover. Really helped out a lot. So in spiritual path, you do the wow. You do the really wow it. Make sure you wow. That's like a sports recovery drink. Wowing it. It's like spiritual nutrition. Make sure you do the spiritual nutrition drink, spiritual recovery drink of wowing it. Stay hydrated. Stay physically hydrated. Stay spiritually hydrated. So many people are dehydrated, spiritually dehydrated, to an abominable extent. Wow. There's nobody admonishing one another anymore in a repentant way. It's just the yoga girl feminist culture is just staring at you, frowning, like, you know, don't you realize I'm made of glass, don't you? Don't you dare do anything I don't want you to do. Make sure you do whatever I tell you to do immediately. And then I'll be okay. If you don't, I think I'm going to break, you know, break. But anyway, that's arrogance. Repentant mind is not going to break like that. So they say, you have to serve my arrogance. No, we don't. No, we don't. Let the dead bury the dead. We're serving repentance here. Jesus calls us to serve repentance, not serve arrogance. And he says, okay, if they don't like you, he said, just, if they don't like you, keep in mind they hated me before they hated you. See? He knew they'd hate him. So people here, they hate the truth. Arrogance hates the truth. Arrogance hates repentance. But Jesus showed us that we have the right to witness to God's plan of salvation here. And I really ask them to give us more encouragement on that, because it's really tough now. We don't want to rock anyone's boat here. We think we're committing some unpardonable social faux pas. Really, like they off with your head, you know. It's like that. If they had the laws, I think they would do it. I mean, if they brought back the guillotine, I think a lot of these feminists would be guillotining people right now. Truly. If it was legal, yeah. You know, it would be the French Revolution. Madame Defarge, you know, and Robespierre and whoever, you know, they would be guillotining the heads of people all day long. Literally, they would be doing that. No, I have no doubt about it. And they would love to be able to bring those laws back, actually. And, you know, Madame Hillary may very well do so. I mean, the French went cuckoo in the French Revolution, did they not? They just said, let's just clean the house, clean the slate, and let's just guillotine everybody. And the Soviets did the same thing, right? They ended up, you know, eliminating their own party, everybody in their own party. Cultural Revolution, the Chinese did the same thing, Gang of Four, and was Mao's wife, or who was that? I mean, they were just insane. They just went crazy. You don't think that materialists won't do that here? You think, oh no, we're all safe? Really? What have we been? What kind of trends have we been safe from here? every bad trend. It seems like every bad trend has caught on here and become the new fashion. So we're really going to say, oh, no. Who has the brakes? I don't see any brakes at all. I don't see any admonishments. I don't see repentance. It's like there's no brakes. So if there's no brakes, why are we supposed to assume that trouble cannot find us here? It's a naive assumption. We're working our way towards the end, so we're just cooling down here. I'm starting to feel the fatigue of I didn't sleep last night. I had another horrible night. I need a new pillow. The Tempur-Pedic pillows, they're too hot when it gets summertime. Your head doesn't feel comfortable. They're too heavy and hot. You need something that's a light and airy kind of, but not that doesn't suffocate. So I got a buckwheat. I'm gonna order a buckwheat Sobakawa original buckwheat pillow. I used to have one of those for many years. I loved it. I could sleep great on that. Your head stays cool. Your head doesn't sink down and I'm meshed on the sides at all, really. No, it's a small pillow. I'm going to try that because I'm not sleeping at all these days. It's brutal. When the heat has come and it's just get too hot, the pillow's too hot, so uncomfortable. Gosh, it's uncomfortable. So, why can't we change? Here's another thing. Why can't we change pillows depending on how we feel? Tonight is this pillow. Tomorrow is this other pillow. I've got like, how many pillows do I have? Like one, two, three. I have three now. I have four. And sometimes this pillow works, and other times you feel like, sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't. Almond Joys has nuts. Mounds don't. Why not try this pillow tonight? Tonight I feel like this pillow. I don't know. People don't do that, do they? Again, becoming more and more and more robotic. It's an insidious plague. It's a hideous, insidious plague. It's probably way worse than we know. Jesus knows how bad it is. Longchenpa knows how bad it is. The Dharma Kings know how bad it is. They have something up their sleeve for us. They really do. Again, it may be a shift to another realm, another dwelling place. I don't see how we can roll it back here. Roboticism is... So someone told me, this Montana, all the tech companies up there like crazy. They're just a massive, insane, frenzied billet boom up there in Montana. It's like another Silicon Valley. And they're doing that all over the place, all over the world. Yes, spread the roboticism everywhere. It's unrepentant, arrogant fools. So it may be, like Jesus said, he'd come back and he'd take us to his dwelling place that he's prepared for us. He said, that's the plan. That's what he says. Jesus, but it's reported in the Gospels that this is what Jesus said. I cannot confirm this, although he did invite me to his dwelling place, and it was not here in this world. So I guess I can confirm it. I said, where is it? Is it far away? He said, no, it's very nearby, but certainly not here. I said, yeah, I'd love to go there. I can only imagine it's just so apropos, right? So spot on in every way. It's just so, yeah. I'd love to see what it's like. Experience what it's like. Ah, bird just went flying by. I tell birds, come up and say hello. Don't always keep your distance. Come on. Hop right up and hop up here on the computer and do a little dance. A little chirping dance. I'd love to see a little bird come up here and do a little chirping dance. Then you could fly away. Well, why can't you take, like, because they're always in pursuit. Can you not take, like, 10 seconds out of your day, bird, to come by and say hello to us and just do a little song and dance for us? Why not? Lighten our day? Yeah, I don't get the wild animals, why they don't just go up and say hello. I mean, I know whether we treat them nicely or not, seems like they would still do the same. The birds just... They keep their distance. Get too close, boom, they fly off. If only had one bird come up and be close like that, a blue jay would come right here and just fly right in here and perch real close and just watch me tape, intently watch me tape. It's amazing. That bird was something different than a bird. It just hung out here for months and months. Finally, it left. But it was telling me something. Like, I want you to be taping here. Something. And yeah, it was amazing that bird was completely different than all other birds. Wasn't afraid of me at all. Got real close and would just perch there. And just sit there, just staring at me like Darshan. Or like, I want to hear your videos. I want you to do video. I want to hear what you have to say. I'll listen. It was quite extraordinary. And used to visit all the time, fly in. Haven't seen a blue jay since. It disappeared. No blue jay since then. So I say, hey birds, you know, come on. Fly in and hang out. You know, maybe you could probably stand to hear this too. I'd say everybody could stand to hear it. It's good for them. Very good for them. Very good for us, right? Repent. Next time you're walking in your car, say, how am I walking in my car? Do I have to keep walking this way? Is this how I really want to walk? Is it? We're so unoriginal. We're so cookie-cuttered. So roboticized that everybody just has to plod along. I mean, what am I doing? Why am I just plodding along? Can't I still skip and, you know, clap my hands or something? Like, yeah, I feel zestful and I feel free. Oh, no, we're supposed to not feel free. Oh, yeah. I'll be...